Well, check this car out. There's a lot done to it since you guys last saw it. Been busy working away with the colder weather now, staying indoors. I gotta admit, guys, this Alero, when I first got it and started tearing it apart, stripping it out, I wasn't too excited about it. I had a feeling, you know, it wasn't gonna be a terribly strong car. But after working on it and actually building it a bit, I'm pretty excited for it. It may still only be a one-run car. We might get two runs out of it. We'll see. But I'm kind of curious to see what it'll do. I've done a lot of different stuff to this car that I've not done to any other car because I want this to be my experimental car. I want to try some theories, see how they work. If they do good, I will apply them to cars that I really want to build. So starting up here in the front is where most of my changes have been done since you guys last saw this car. You will notice it now has a front bumper. Pretty pumped about that. That is on, good to go. Remember our rules, what we're allowed to do. We can swap the bumper out. You cannot weld the bumper to the car, but you can weld a metal plate to the car, and then you bolt your bumper to that plate. If you're the only downfall is if you do swap bumpers, you have to only use 3 bolts per side of the bumper on the car, and they specify the exact size of bolt it has to be. I can't remember, couldn't remember if these were 5/16 or whatever. I'd have to look at the rules and see. But we have to have that exact size and that number of bolts to hold our bumper on if we swap bumpers. If you run the factory stock bumper, you can keep however many bolts, however big of bolts, are on that bumper when it came from the factory. So it's your choice what you want to do. I always personally swap bumpers unless the factory one I think is strong. The one that was on this car is plastic, so obviously swapping it's the choice to do. So yes, we do have that on there. And you will see our hood design is quite different here. We did move it forward. And now keep in mind, I really did not move this hood that much forward. It's very deceiving when you're looking at it because it's sticking out so much. But these fenders on this car, I folded them back here. These fenders would stick out to here. So this hood stuck way out originally on its own. I only moved it forward about 6 inches. And the reason I did that, if you look back here, here's the computer to this car. It took a while, but I finally managed to get it on top of the firewall, welded it down, bolted it down. It's not going anywhere. This computer was actually located right up here, right behind the plastic bumper on the frame itself. Terrible location. As soon as somebody came in on a corner shot, as soon as that frame bent, that computer was junk. So I undid that, and the wiring harness was very, very stiff, very short. Could not get it to reach even barely under the engine compartment. So I traced all the wires to this whole entire harness to see where they went, found out the thing that was holding me back was the ABS brake unit right here. ABS stands for automatic braking system, and when you brake, it keeps your brakes from locking up. They go on and off real fast. So I did an experiment, wanted to see what would happen if I would unplug that unit, how my car would work. Unplugged it, plugged the computer back in, hooked everything else up, drove the car for a test drive. Believe it or not, this car runs great and actually stops better with the ABS unhooked. I think that's because on the Derby, when you slam your brakes on, they're going to lock up, you know, you stop real quick. On the road, you may not want that to happen, cause a wreck. So this ABS unit is just kind of sitting there now as padding up front to protect my engine. It'll hit that first. So unplug that, and with that unplugged, it was able to extend my wires, get the whole harness up here out of the way, mount my computer nice and safe. As you'll see here, here's another part of the harness coming up here into the firewall. It runs right next to the strut. Probably the safest spot under the hood of a car is your strut tower. Anything you can attach to your strut tower for a front-wheel drive, go ahead and do that. I've never seen one of them have something up here get destroyed unless the car ramps on top of you, which will be a weakness to this car since we did have that hood slid forward. If somebody comes on top of me, their wheel could potentially fall down in this hole, get them hung up. If they spin the tires, you know, whatever, shred everything under here. We'll just keep our fingers crossed that don't happen. But yeah, I did move this forward because, one, I have wiring coming out right here that it would pinch. And two, my computer is now in the way. This hood would not close and shut down with all the computer stuff here. So that's moved. I did manage to fold that down a little bit in the front. I've seen it done on a bunch of other cars in the 2016 Demolition Derby season. Looks like it's passing just fine. I'm going to go ahead and do it on mine. Doesn't really help a ton, but it does offer some protection to your radiator. And this car has a crap, I mean absolute crap, radiator mount. And I'm going to show you one of those reasons why. This little thin piece of plastic, yeah, that's plastic. That's not even metal. There's a plastic support that runs under this, and that's the bottom of your core support to hold this radiator in. So if that snaps off, there's nothing under your radiator. The radiator itself is held in up above also, so if this does break off, it's not like the whole thing's going to drop out of the car, but it's just a really crappy design. Even for a car on the road, this is a really crappy design. If you hit a high snowdrift or an animal like a raccoon, possum, something bigger, they come under your car, really easy to snap this thing off that's holding your radiator core support by hitting an animal. Stupid, stupid design just to make your car lightweight. Now, I was going to go ahead and start this car up for you guys today, drive it out into the sunshine, and, you know, show you everything else around it that I can get to in the back, but unfortunately, some stupid person, being me, forgot that when he relocated all the wires, I did not extend my battery cables yet. This still has the original battery cables under the hood, and if you put the battery in the original spot right down here, the new battery cables do not reach it no more because I moved the computer and the harness closer to the firewall. So this thing will start up and we'll do a test drive with it later on once I get some more extensions for my battery cables to run to the interior of the car. Let's talk about the interior then while we're at it. I made some huge improvements this time on this car, something I'm pretty excited about. Each year I try to improve the interior layout of my vehicles. Last year my goal was to make things simplified. The minimum as possible, have everything grouped into clusters so I don't have wiring all over my car, much easier to work with and diagnose problems. Well, for 2017, my goal is to design a setup for battery, gas tank, and switches that no longer mounts to the floor of a car. I just want to be able to take the whole cage and everything, cut it out, put it into another car, have multiple cages floating around that I could put in a bunch of different cars that already have my mounts and boxes set up on them. This will save a ton of time. Also saves when you're running multiple vehicles to switch them in and out of cars if you only have a week between two derbies like I do sometimes. It also helps for these compacts. Sometimes when the back comes in, the floor of your car can actually drop down onto the ground if it's rusty or bends funky in the back. So now, by no longer having any of your stuff attached to the floor, you eliminate one future problem that could happen. I do not have a gas tank yet. We talked about that once it's put in. But up front here, we have our new switches. Very simple design. I have my door bar right here with this gusset brace and my seat bar. Switches are made out of angle iron, and it comes right here, and I have three switches welded in place to this angle iron. Of course, they're not wired up yet, but they are there. Now, they are not high up to hurt me. They're actually angled down. Let's see if I can show you a better view from the back window. See how they slant downwards? They're actually very low to my tranny tunnel there towards the floor. So for any reason, if I get hit hard and I fall sideways in the seat, I will not stab myself on those switches. Something I need to change on my old pre-ran green Lumina. I did not like how high those switches were, so we moved them down. Now we have our battery box, which you'll notice is color-coded yellow. I've spray-painted all of my nuts and bolts, all of my stuff that pertains to my battery, yellow. All of my nuts and bolts and stuff that pertain to my gas tank, I spray-painted red. This is so I don't lose them in my garage, because I keep losing all of my stuff. So I need to spray-paint this cover here, my strap that holds it down, but this unit itself is floating. Kind of see there, it does not go into the floor. It's about 3 or 4 inches off the floor. And it's just a basic battery box. I made a new one out of angle iron. It has this piece here, a threaded rod. You put your battery in, this piece gets bolted down tight, holds your battery in place. But it has angle iron welded to my gusset off the cage. So it's now floating off the floor. What I will do eventually is I'm going to hopefully buy a second gas tank. I only have one fuel cell right now. Bought that from M&M Boys. I like it a lot. Probably going to buy another one from them. This time I'm going to buy one without the razor legs, the extensions. It's going to be very short, low to the ground. And I'm going to actually weld some pieces of angle coming off of my door bars from now on, my seat bars, and run them back and bolt my gas tank onto that so it's a floating gas tank, not attached to the floor. But I'm not sure when I'm buying that. Maybe we'll get it on sale for Christmas. We'll see. So that's pretty awesome. Pretty excited about all those changes. I'll probably show you guys a much better breakdown when I have it all done, all the wiring done, show you what's all going on with it. And one of the last improvements I've made to this car recently is this right here. Big old C-channel door bar. protect me. I'm going to start doing this on a lot more of my cars. I've been slacking on safety for driver's door. It happens very easy with these front-wheel drive stock classes. People are driving backwards. They spin around, don't see a shot. Somebody gets hit. Your brakes go out. Somebody gets hit. You know, whatever. It's crazy. It does happen. So what I do is I got a big piece of C-channel, pretty thick plating. We got holes through it, and these holes go through the car, and they bolt itself right in there. You kind of see it's kind of dark. I have my bolts through the door skin, holding it in place. So that's definitely going to be a big improvement. I will still put my giant padding, as you can see my cushion right there, waiting to go in this car to help me for that. One thing you'll notice missing from this car is it does not have a rollover bar, a halo bar yet. And that's because I ran out of metal for cage material. I'm going to be getting some more, hopefully, with a sale coming up this winter. The local supplier I buy metal from always has a sale in the winter. I usually don't buy metal all year long and wait until that one day for that, bring a bunch of money, bring my bus, load up on a bunch. I should have enough for another 3 or 4 cars. The only reason I ran out of cage material is because I have so many pre-ran derby cars that are sitting around right now that still run and drive. I have not pulled any cage material out of those cars. I save everything I can when I pull my cars apart, but those cages are stuck in those cars till I get rid of them. So that's enough of me blabbing for you guys today. Hope you like the updates on the Alero. I'm pretty excited about it. I think it's turning out to be a pretty cool little car. Definitely a super fast car. We'll do some more work on it. Still, I'd say it's about 60% done. So a lot of little things to go, and I do need to spend some more time on the trunk still. So stay tuned on further updates with the 2000 style Alero.